Yeah, okay. You have to go. Have it.
Start.
My first idea is to give a whole idea of the different tools that are required in the organization and why we're working on them. There's a whole world of proprietary software localization and content localization, but we're also working with very closely and trying to learn from them what are the things that are that they are doing that we're not doing that will make our work easier. And it comes down to computer-assisted localization. So we have the editors that we use to translate, to do localization, sometimes peer edit, in which we have just very uncontrolled localization. We have a source string, we translate it, we send it back. So we're using open source to a very unstructured way of doing localization. There's a lot of work done with closures.
The question is, if you have put the profile to the translation, is this PO file in frozen or something like this? Not our translation can get also the same, and two people make the same work. Have you like a booking chain or something?
Well, I think that currently Javier is not showing us.
Yeah, okay,
just more general about.
Okay. So,
is. In some systems are actually used quite actively. So for us, the ideal type of work is first to have a very clear glossary, but then to be able to use it when you do translation. Somebody mentioned this idea before, that whenever you're translating something, the words that are in your glossary somehow show.
Nice.
You can go much farther than that. You can actually say, please enforce this glossary, or give me a ring when the translation doesn't have the words that are supposed to be translated.
Mm-hmm.
So we can control that the glossary is being used. We can control many of these things, and we can control them online or offline. So this is still an offline translation editor. It's actually not a real problem. My wish list. PRM doesn't do this. But the ones that we're trying to do will do that. Translation memory. One of the main problems is that usually localization in open source is not independently in each program.
Yeah.
So there is very little sharing of translation memory or resources that are being used. So we think that an important issue is to be able to share this translation memory across projects. The next thing is process and quality. The translation process can have, as you say, many, many steps. You have translation, you can have review, you can have an approval later. But what's very important is that you don't repeat the work. And with PO files, this is complicated, for example. You have created a PO file, it has only three messages that need to be translated now. And the translator knows that only these three messages need to be translated. But once they are translated, the reviewer doesn't know this. The reviewer sees a 1,000 message PO file that he has to review, but the reviewer doesn't know the work that was just done before by the translator. He sees a file with 1,000 messages that are all translated. So by controlling process, by controlling the work that was done in the stage before, you can save a lot of work. You can do a much better localization process. You can do a lot of checking of things. For example, what we saw before about the glossary. Maybe you can use one standard glossary, but when the file goes to the reviewer, it says, by the way, these three messages do not use a standard glossary. Please check them, or do something, it's your problem. We give you the information now on the statistics. These messages have this problem, these other messages have this other problem.
Actually, the issue you talk about on translations not being able to check what changed to the profile are essentially true, but not always true. Because for most translations, I use SDM systems, like CVS or SDM.
Uh-huh.
Reviewers can check out. I mean, if you do a check-in of the flashy translation and then do a check-in of the translator's stuff, you can easily see what the translation actually did from when he did an MSC merge and then he actually translated that. So that's for someone to be a debut installer, that's something that is done automatically, so you can actually see quite easily what has a translator done to update the translation in every release of the message file. So you can actually see, if you want to review the translation change, you can actually see them very easily if you have a source code control system in place.
In the French team, I think from big PO file, we when just an update, we send the patch and also the complete PO file. I think having a review of the complete PO file is also a feature. Because the more review you get, the better the translation will be.
Yeah, but I think that what Javier was wanting to enhance, and it's important to enhance,
but
it's having being able to review what needs to be reviewed is a common need. We solve it by sending batch files. You can solve it by using the SEO or whatever. The important point, I think, is we need that feature actually.
Yes.
It's important when there is an update to see what has been updated. And for instance, to have not everything reviewed, it's good if everything
and
is reviewed.
The PO form.
Yeah.
We have to do
PO as a PO
so
I
you have OpenOffice from 2.02 to 2.03, then you have 500 messages in across all the files. But you don't want to review all of OpenOffice.
Yeah.
Only those that have 500 messages.
But it's important to have some history. Yeah, go on.
Yeah. But otherwise,
but process gives you a lot of sense. Once you see the files in your view, and then we will see why XDF is interesting, because it makes the files. You can put all this process inside the file, so that when the file goes and comes back, then everything is in the file. You can actually know who reviewed and translated each message. So that brings you to localization management tools, in which you have the central, what I think was the same thing that was maintaining on back office, something that controls these files and helps movement between the host project to the team leader for that language, the translators, the viewers. So the tool that manages all this, that for us is the future of Kudu. Documentation and other contents, it's very clear to us that we have to manage that too. That whatever tools we do have to work for software and content.
But isn't that a matter of changing documentation to be translatable, like using PO files?
Well, there are things that change, because when you're doing a documentation, you need much more context than when you're doing single messages.
All right. But, I'm not saying that we do PO files with every stream, but actually the tools we use in Debian for translation, like Debian Installer Manual, actually use PO files for some languages. I think maybe 5 or 6 of them. Russian is included, maybe Chinese.
Most of them actually.
Spanish and French.
French
is not. German is not. So I think it's maybe half and half. But and actually works because the tools we have don't actually match strings, but match paragraphs. You have the content there. Okay, so if they convert from XML files to PO files and back. So
I don't know, what is the point?
The point is
translation of documentation or documentation of the translation?
No, translation of documentation.
Yeah.
So the thing is that whatever you do, you have to make sure that the tools that you do also work
documentation.
Yeah. If you try to use a PO editor, like PO edit, documentation, it works, but you don't have the context. You don't have the three sentences before.
You actually do. I mean, that's what I'm saying. You might want to check out the whole XML tools we're using because they actually work with XML files, so you can get the paragraph itself and not the strings.
Yes.
So you can actually translate the whole paragraph as a whole. The only problem with that, and that's a big issue, is that when slight change is made of the paragraph, you get the translation as fuzzy. And it's not that easy to see where is the slight change. Maybe it was a typo change, and you get the whole translation as a problem. So it's not actually tools. All tools actually work on. We've been using that for XML files for the full Debian installer manual is in XML, and there's some of the manuals that are actually in XML and are being used with both files to handle that and man pages too. So they actually work with some minor caveats. So it's not a matter of maybe, I mean, PO can be used for that.
Yeah. The only issue with that is when you go to translation memory, you want to always mask the smallest possible sentence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
XLib is doing some changes in that, so that you can put phrase separators inside the target,
mm-hmm.
so that you can actually match parts of the target and not the whole thing. Mm-hmm. So if you change something, only small part of your sentence, or phrase, the rest will be matched again in translation memory. But the important thing is
there is something specific to documentation
and
translation.
Yeah. At the end, the main problem of localization is maintenance. You can do a lot of maintenance, it's not easy and very cheap and resources, then it doesn't happen. So, process is especially good for maintenance. And the future, maybe translation memory, machine translation,
That's AI, and that's not
going to happen. We say machine-assisted translation.
Yeah. But the thing is, this might work for a few European languages.
Yeah.
But it would never work for radio.
Okay.
And our main issue here is that we think that everything has to be done using the standards.
Mm-hmm.
There are standards now for translation. There's no ASCII standard at XLib.
Mm-hmm.
There are standards now from the localization industry, standards association, for translation memory information, for terminology, for segmentation of text, for word counting. So there are quite a number of standards that are coming out specific for this.
Actually, some of them are ESO standards, right?
Not yet, I think.
But they were going through the standardization process of ESO?
But it would be only XLib.
Oh, yeah.
Because the others are from LISA, the Localization Industry Standards Association, and there are people who are not very happy with it.
Okay.
I'm the OSCAR meeting, which is the LISA standards meeting.
Mm.
But it's, but I think there's a lot of talk about those standards. But XLib is the only one that's clearly the future of localization for both industry and I think open source. Industry is slowly moving. You have the big manufacturers like IBM, HP, business objects already creating easily files for the translation. And they're trying to force all the localization industry, all the tool providers, to use XLib just to be free of some of the big guys. I mean, they're running into the usual, the problem that everybody has. The tool manufacturers, the best known tool for localization is called Trados. Now it's owned by a localization service provider who is not interested in giving the best tool to its competitors.
Yeah.
So it's developing better tools inside and has stopped development of the tool.
He doesn't want to use standards or competitors.
And this is going to force movement, and this is forcing movement towards XLib.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is very good for us. This is not really, but you know how different the files and the all applications and open source are. This is good for non-hospital, so. The problems, project-specific localization, everybody has their own tools.
I hope you can talk about that.
You know, we can see what's happening in Mozilla.
Yeah, with XPS, that's right.
And we're trying to take Mozilla into PO files. So we work with your partner, Mozilla.
Actually, even brought a tool to convert XPI files to code, right?
Yeah, I wanted to hack a bit, so I did it. I did it and restarted. I have previously translated Mozilla and Firefox and everything.
Uh-huh.
And recently, I made the tool to convert from XPI to PO, and then from PO to XPI to have the translation, and restarted the translation. But some other people have begun with it too, so I don't know.
That's what we do in the Translate Toolkit.
Hmm?
Also, we do that in the Translate Toolkit.
Oh.
So at the end, for us, the big problem is that you have to maintain localization teams with a lot of skills. You need to know how to use Mozilla Translator when it's not broken, other localization tools. So tending to the standards is always the this was my speech for people to use the standards, so I'm going to skip it here.
Because actually, those are shared. between translation projects. At least Genome, KDA, and some other the language teams do share the glossary because they are actually the same stuff.
I think this argument is a good one.
Yeah.
Very difficult for when you want to do localization project like the MailOS project. I may understand it may be difficult to coordinate everything.
But I see it in many countries that there's somebody doing Mozilla and somebody doing OpenOffice, they don't know each other.
Yeah.
If you cross the Mozilla localization list and the OpenOffice localization list, there are two or three people who are in both projects. So there's still sharing of information.
Well, even if people don't, I mean, there's even if there's not the same people, I wouldn't say there's not sharing information because all those guys put up glossaries. And I mean, I've for the Debian glossary, the Debian Spanish translation team glossary, I've derived from the KDE and Genome project, even though I'm not in the KDE or in the Genome project, because the closure is up. So, I mean, there's information flow between projects, even though there's not the same people in each project. So, but maybe that's not clear from the outside. But, I mean, if you take the Debian closure, it's quite like the KDE closure. It actually points to the KDE and Genome closure.
And I think that this mission is high cost for managers. We're seeing new localization effort, people starting a new project and starting from the beginning, starting from zero. And it could be really easy to borrow from other people. So people tend to work in isolation in most cases with high cost and low quality. Low quality many times due to this isolation. Because people start without experience, without they might read the glossary, but it's not the same thing to read the glossary than to use it. So people without experience and uncontrolled tools would tend to produce low quality.
That's maybe a very negative side of flaws. That's not my experience with translation work in free software. I mean, it's not that bad. You put it very bad. I don't know what the message.
Well, I think that
because I have to put it very bad so that I can talk.
It's not that bad. I mean, it's way too pessimistic for us.
This is the wrong side of the table problem.
Yeah.
In flaws, yeah.
Okay, not the good side. We have a standard, that's the good side. That's the old. It's the factory standard, and that means that there are a number of editors that work with this standard. And the nice thing, the thing that has to happen somehow, we're working with translators more and more that are not technical people. So we have to separate the translation part of the organization from the technical part. And this sort of tool is what it's going to do. Is there any tool that separates that is going to do things. So what is to be done, facilitate is to use common formats and make sure that we center the efforts to make only one set of good tools. And tools that apply the most modern techniques of computer assisted translation and localization. Reducing the learning curve for localizers. My concern is usually localizers from very small countries who have no experience, who have...
Even with computers, right?
Yeah, even with computers.
Uh-huh.
And who... somebody will develop a glossary, but everybody else will hate them for doing that. Because the people who know English very well and can do translation, they don't see a reason why you should use local language.
Because it's fancy, so you don't have to go to very small.
Very typical problem.
Huh?
Very typical problem.
And but this is a huge problem in Africa. In Africa, it's a huge problem. People don't localize because they don't see the need.
Yeah,
they don't.
You'll see the talk
with the localization outside of South Africa. The guys from the computer, you know?
But
we use it in French, and that's okay.
Yeah, actually, I read an article on IEQ, a magazine that was talking about Africa software, and actually there were a lot of shops that were making software, and the big advantage for them, and they got funding from Microsoft, and the big advantage for them, you know, they were making like software to make, to manage a shop. So like, you know, sell stuff, inventory stuff, and you know, finance stuff, and the big bonus, and that's why they would But finding from Microsoft is that they actually could localize stuff and make it proper for the guy. So I mean, maybe the high tech guy that you know runs through South Africa with laptop doesn't want localization, but the guy in the shop that doesn't.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, this is what
the user wants localization.
Yeah, the user wants localization.
But there was a study not long ago by a few NGOs in Africa, technology NGOs. And they actually ask all these people who have labs, computer labs,
yeah, okay,
and
they don't.
Places, and they all say localization for what?
What for? Yeah. Yeah.
This is what I summarized last year. English sucks. We have to say this to all hackers, to all people. English sucks. English is not the way to go. This is not the user's language. And we have to repeat this all the time.
No, there's a number of studies that show this. And we're planning to do a study in which we actually prove this.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, it was an economist showing when you teach people in local language and in English. We want to do it in India because India claims that English is a very important language in India. And we can show that even in a place where English is very important, some people learn, some people don't. And it depends only on the language mm-hmm. that you use.
Mm-hmm.
But coming back to the subject, it's important that when you start new projects, the curve is very small, so that you know the tools. So we try to use the same tools for all projects. Tools must have tight links to upstream projects, so that you can actually integrate things. For example, now we are connecting directly to Putl to building OpenOffice.
Mm-hmm.
So we build OpenOffice directly from Putl. On stable version. And there's somebody else that has the latest build. So we can connect very well to that. We can probably not connect to Mozilla, but I'm sure that we can connect to anybody who has CDS.
Why not? Because
they don't want. They have their own infrastructure, they have their own very, very technical thing.
It's actually very hard to use even for technical things. It's hard to use even for technical things.
Yes, and they have all these permissions and sometimes take 9 months before they accept the translations.
Yeah.
So there are all these issues that complicate things. We don't use the trademarks, we use different names for the products, and we work just as open source. Mozilla and Firefox are still the easiest to localize products ever, because you can do an independent language file and put it in,
mm-hmm.
even if it's forbidden if you use the trademarks. So we want the translators to translate and then try to get the infrastructure to do the rest of the work. And then our goal is to provide the projects, in this case like Debian, with the infrastructure so that they don't have to develop their own. And this is what we do. So this works for us. The project to simplify the process of localization software. Trying to increase quality, thinking of the world of volunteer translators. Develop a complete set of tools for computer system localization. Trying to do what we said before, try to do the best possible job with the unexperienced people, translators. And then a methodology to ensure the quality of the translation. So understand really the localization process and try to use it in a very flexible way that you can use different processes. But at the same time, whenever you decide what your process is, to be able to enforce it. And then, what I was saying, infrastructure to provide finished applications like OpenOffice. So our components are conversion features. We have a number of features for different formats and then in second level for different projects. So for Mozilla you would have the properties files, but then you have to open the XPA file and prepare things for the web for localization. That will be second level. All our features produce either PO or XP interchangeably. So that we can allow people to work in whatever format they want.
Nice
one. Yeah, it's a nice drawing of what we were wanting to say in our slides. Mm-hmm. Modularity, actually.
you put everything.
I've been online for Barcelona. Formats. Let me talk a little bit about PO. We're working with PO files, and we think that the future is with XD files. XD files are XML files, so the very specific format is an OASIS
standard.
That is changing very little, so it's now 1.1.1. 2.0 will come out of just fixing very small things. So it's actually quite stable. We think that has a lot of advantages. Using the same standard for post and for private industry. Same standard for software and for content. Can store many more types of data. Actually, XLIT is quite well known. You can put some data on, you can put a lot of translation memory inside the file, you can put glossary information inside the file. So you can do a self-contained file that can go to the translator without further intervention, without further information. You can put results of tests. So you can put in the file that these three messages do not agree with the glossary. And you put that in the file, as part of the file. So when it goes to the next stage, the information is there already. You can put counters at the end of the file that say how many messages have this condition. So then it's easy, very easy to run statistics on the set of files of the project. You can put alternate translations. So you can put French in there. And then it's the problem of your translation editor to say which language do I put on the top. The one that is the source, or the one that I have for French in the alternative language. I can say that my central system is putting any translation memory match that has a match of more than 70%. And I just put them there. I don't put them in the target, I put them as alternative translations. And then it's up to the offline or the localization editor used by the translator to say, I take this or I don't take this. Or I enforce this or I don't enforce this. But you have the information in the PO file in a structure. And then you can put the process information. You can define different stages that the file goes through. You can go through enrichment with the translation memory and glossary. You can go through a phase of translation. You can go through, and each message, each translation is associated to a phase. And this is a very important thing. So when the translator translates only the three messages that need to be translated, out of 1,000, they are associated to a phase. And then when it goes to review, the reviewer says, okay, I only want the work from the last phase. Or I want everything, it's his choice. And then he can say, okay, I review this, and he can get the statistics of this file has three messages that do not agree with the glossary, or three messages that have problems with capitalization, or that have the space at the end of the sentence that the original doesn't have. So we can actually test quite a large number of things in the translation editor, very close to the translator. We think that all the tests should be as close to the translator as possible. And this is the interesting thing of modularity. Tests that we can do for the central system, we can also run on the translation editor, so that the translator knows right away that he made a mistake. Or no, or that he can think and say no. I like my translation, and I send it back. All this information can go there, in the file. We can put the translation memory information in the file, other languages of reference, data markup. Very important, you can say in this message, do not translate this part. So when I think, for example, OpenOffice help, we have parts of text that are XML that should not be touched. So we can mark this as do not touch. We can mark variables as do not touch, but they have to be in the translation. So you can enforce that the variable is untouched in the translation. The filters will be the ones that will mark the text for each project. But then the tools are the same for all projects. So we think that with all these things we can improve the quality of translation by using more information. Then translation editors can use this information in whichever way they want, but the information is there in the file. Other standards, standard for the translation memory exchange, TMX. You're going to have a database of messages that were translated before. But if you want to give it to somebody else, you want to change between projects, then you can use TMX. You can use DBX for terminology, for glossaries. And then coming back to the WordPress project. So conversion filters to standard formats. That's where I start with this. Glossary tools for glossary management. But anyway, you can use any tool that produces PDFs, because then we will use the standard format. That's our goal. And then when you want to put the glossary information inside the XLIP file, then you have a black box that you can get the XLIP file, you can get the glossary in standard format, and then it will output a XLIP file which is enriched. But you can change that for any other component that does the same thing if you use standard formats. Same thing for translation memory. If you use standard formats, the tool that you use for managing the translation memory is irrelevant. We will do one, but if anybody wants to change or they have a better one, they can use that, and they will use DNX, and then we can use that. Number of tests. More and more we can do tests that are cross-project tests. We can mark the variables inside the text. We don't have to have an intelligent editor that knows the format of the variables of OpenOffice or Mozilla. They are both marked as don't touch this and has to be on the translation. So we can do more and more standard tests. We can program which tests that you want to do. For example, we can test for punctuation. There's punctuation in the original, there should be punctuation on the translation. But then you have to make it programmable, because for example in Thai there's no punctuation. Or in Khmer we use a different sign. So you need a number of standard localization programmable tests. And these tests, again, the results of the tests, when they are positive, when there's a problem, then can be put back into the files. So that when it moves to the reviewer or to the approver, translation manager, they know that this problem is there without having to look at the translations. We're working on an offline translation method that will try to implement all these things. And then we're also trying to work on project side tools. We're interested in understanding, for example, what Debian needs on the project side. On how do you do your internal process to CDS, for example? From code to CDS, how do you upgrade it? You're probably using GetText. Can GetText be upgraded to XLIP or produced whichever one? I've heard that there's somebody doing that. And we have a project also to try to do that. We haven't found anybody to do that. We have an online translation editor, which is the original Poodle. The original idea of Poodle was doing an online translation editor. But then Poodle became the translation management system, becoming a file server for translatable files. So that you can either edit, you can see the statistics of what's happening, or you can download files, you can upload files. By upload, I mean I don't copy the file and upload the file. I can actually, I merge the file from the translator on the one that I have in Poodle. Because the one in Poodle may be a newer one. We will use XLIP as an internal format, but we can export XLIP or PO, and we can upload XLIP or PO. But as XLIP has more information, we will always keep our internal format in XLIP, because that way we keep our information. If that makes sense. We're now trying to specify this as much as possible, so that's why I think we're in a very good moment. For the stance, what is needed from the different projects. I think I have a number of ideas. Part of what we want to do is advanced statistics tools, goal management, rights management. What he was saying is very important. You need somebody to take control of the project, to be able to delegate to translators, reviewers, understand very well I don't want to see the hierarchy, but who gives rights to whom?
Mm-hmm.
So that you can have a controlled localization environment. Who can upload files? Who can edit them online? Who can review? Who can only translate? So there's quite a number of things that need to be defined. And by defining goals for the project, you can also define the productivity that needs to be implemented for the project to meet deadlines. So if that OpenOffice 2.0.4 has to be on the 15th of July, you know that you have to do 15 streams a day at least. Our idea is to try to have a system where most people work offline, but they are encouraged to upload their content as often as possible so that the statistics on the system can be maintained. A bit like KDE is doing, or GNOME.
Yeah, with CDS, you mean?
CDS would be behind as a backup system.
I mean, they're using CDS for translations. You mean like how they do that? They push all the translators use CDS and they just submit to CDS their new translations on the fly while they're working on it?
That's the idea, but we believe that CDS is a hacker tool.
No, yeah, I mean, I'm not saying that CDS
but
CDS,
that's it. Yeah. And then the next day you have the statistics, you know what's happening. And the more often that people upload things, the better are your statistics.
Mm.
The more up to date.
Yeah, the point is, most important point is having them send the material as soon as possible, whatever method is used.
Yeah.
And we come back to our modularity tools. If they want to send it through the online web system, because this is the only thing they can do, okay, or mail, or CVS, or SVN, they can do it. Depends on the skills of translators and coordinators. I think you meant exactly what I've met in Libyan work. You have very skilled translators and translation teams, mostly in the biggest ones, and you have some very small teams of people who are less skilled. This is my experience with a Vietnamese translation team in Libyan, who is made of one woman actually. You know about her.
I have very good news for that.
Yeah.
We are bringing the whole Vietnamese community here.
Oh, that's really nice to that. Anyway, she has no skill, technical skill. I have to teach her SVN a long time.
But she works a lot.
She works a lot.
Hours and hours.
Yeah.
But
she's alone a lot.
Yeah.
She works with other people already.
No, she's the only one. She's made more than some things that are made of one people.
And she doesn't use that.
Yeah.
No, she was
no, it's amazing. That girl is amazing.
Yeah.
Do you know her? Yeah. Do you know that she's very sick?
Yeah.
I don't know, by the way, I don't know if she wants this to be more
public,
so yes, we know.
last week, we have been able to bring modularization of OpenOffice and other things together, also under her control.
That's great, that's great.
She works a lot.
Yeah, she does. She's impressive.
So yes, we were talking about ways to update information and so on.
So basically what we want to do is build a tool that is a transition management system that is basically what you want.
Yeah, you're mostly defining what we were talking before with different words, but that it shows that it's not a surprise to see that we have the same goals.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You have them probably at a higher scale, so we can consider Debian to be one of the interesting projects, maybe one of the biggest, because we have maybe areas we have to work with. But yeah, that makes interesting to
the problem for if we use Pulu, the one thing we'll have to work on is the filter stuff, so we can take stuff from all the different tools that Debian has. So the problem in Debian is that it's not like on KDE or GNOME that you have single CDs with all the stuff, but you have multiple projects that maybe use different source code management system, CVS, SPM, Star, ARC, whatever the apps you want to use. You have source packages. You have source packages that are from Debian, so they are on specific Debian. You have some that are from Debian that you actually want to work with upstream directly instead of going through the Debian package, because then you get, if you try to go this way, you might not get the translation to, but if you go upstream and then back, that would be the best way to translation to the Debian. So actually, if we use Imputo, the thing we probably would be focusing on is first filters for all the stuff we want, and then probably the process that, the management process that needs to be enforced or not, because I mean, some teams do have a management process, some others don't want to use any management process. And the ones that do, have the French team, Spanish team, and what other team? German team?
Dutch
team, yeah. They use the actually the same management process of, you know, translation lock, you would say. So that's the presentation I'm going to work on. So intent to translate, then update translation, then review, and then that. So that's the process that probably needs to be implemented somehow on Imputo.
This is what, yeah, what's specific. Yes. It now needs what's mostly specific if we want to enhance one or two things is the distributed nature of Debian. What Javier said, contrary to GNOME key or open, we don't have any central point. We have we have like 15,000 packages. Among these, like about 15,000 have translatable material, because we want to translate all the package descriptions.
So all packages have main pages.
So all packages have main pages.
Policy to have
not all of them.
Yes.
But not all packages have a good framework to translate the main pages, because you all know that the traditional method to translate main page is absolutely not scalable.
Yes,
so
yes.
We have some work in here. Main page maybe focused on Debian specific tools like dpackage, apt, and where there are like I don't know how many Debian native packages.
Because
there are more Debian native packages, but some should not be Debian native packages, and we often debate with their maintainers. I don't want to listen.
The difference is not necessary.
Yeah, the most important point is we have many sources of information. So Debian is not a single project. It's more like a big collection of small projects. The way the Debian website localization works is not exactly the same the way that the Debian installer manual localization works and so on. And it will probably never be. So, yes, we have to be prepared to have some high modularity.
One of our goals is to be distributed.
Yeah.
So, we'll end up maybe not by the end of the year, but maybe later. Being a distributed system where you have different web servers that communicate with each other. So you know, for Debian projects, the owner will be some for Debian. For other projects, maybe the owner of the project might be somebody else. So you can have web servers for Debian, but Google also have, for example, Google has one for Office and other servers. So part of our work is maintaining servers. So in Spain, it's in Sweden, Roberto Escudero, who is maintaining all the servers for the missions.
Actually, one of the things that might be good to do in Debian, because we were thinking, one of the things in the software, and one of the things how you implement it and how you architect that, one idea is maybe have a single Imputo server for Debian, which might not be a good idea, because each language team has its own resources and might want to manage, you know, kind of micromanage their own Imputo server. So I think there's a competitive team, I don't know which one it is, that has a Imputo server already up and running. They talk about that in the main release.
Stream Debian?
Yeah. In Debian, yeah.
I don't think there is.
Well, yeah, there is, but they mentioned that they started using it. I don't know how
it's like to mention it. It's, of course, it's Bitstream.
Bitstream?
I think Bitstream. I heard from Clayton that Bitstream has.
Ah, Vietnamese?
No, 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 but that she has the translations of which Turkish streams, the Bush stream, the torrent.
The torrent.
Uh-huh. And that they were using the blue server for the translations.
Well, I mean, actually, a language team, a single language team in Debian was using the blue translator.
I didn't.
Check out the menu.
No, it's transig. I think it's transig for one team.
One of the problems we have in a single standard server is that maybe you have issues with that server, then you break all of the translation and stuff. And actually, it might have issues with bandwidth, you know, hardware, whatever, and it might make more sense to have dedicated servers per language and have them distribute it so that, you know, you have a standard server pushing translation down and people are working on this server. Also because the different teams can probably get resources, local resources to you know, provide that service. So they can go out and get bandwidth at their ISP level on the country, you know, their own server, which might be better than maybe doing linking to a server that is on the other side of the ocean. To have a server, you know, locally in your in a place you can go to, in a polo you can go to and see.
On your own land.
Yeah, on your own land. So, well, now probably not because they are countrywide. But yeah, that's, well, maybe on your own back home, you know, country back home. Because at least from the Spanish team, we can actually get funding to put a server up at a very high bandwidth location in Spain, in back home. So, and that might make sense to us to have the translation work there. Well, we actually already have one for the Mineral Network, so it's actually up. And it might make more sense to have one up there that can, that Spanish translation team can manage, but you know, gets the feed, kind of the feed of translation from other other points. That to have, you know, once files, actually files from one.
That's
the only thing we have to look at with this is that there are two ways of upgrading the organization, and you can do it. For example, the way Debian is now, you have to do it language by language from CBS. So I have to go and do Spanish. I have to, for a given file, if I want to upgrade, the upgrade takes place in CDS. It doesn't take place in Putu. And then I import the new file to Putu. But for other languages, for the system like Broken Office, our idea is we bring the POT files, the templates, into Putu. And Putu upgrades the different projects.
Well, actually.
Because there's no CDS.
Okay, yeah.
The master is in Putu.
Mm-hmm. That probably will get issue with upstream maintainers and with you know, with the maintainers that are their own upstream, because they won't have handled the, you know, they won't control all the files. So it might make sense to, like what Christian said, that have an output way to say, okay, Poodle has access rights to the CVS server, so translations don't push updates to CVS, it's Poodle doing it, but in the end it's the upstream CVS or SVN or actual that is the master. Because they don't want to have files outside of that. Because they don't want things like in Ubuntu that the translations are difficult, or KDA even, that they, you know, they have source code, a program here, and you have a package, and then you have package for translations. They still want to give
you. It depends, because there is some needs that emerging for that kind of language part, like they have in Ubuntu. This is a talk I had with Franz Bock recently. Because he begins to worry about me adding more and more languages to VI, you know.
Yeah,
so it's beginning, it's adding a lot of load to VI. So we are thinking about a kind of language pack,
But maybe for VI messages, but not for all.
Yeah, not for most parts of it, you know.
I think it's something that we have to think about.
Yeah.
For this process.
There's something else. We have less than an hour for an hour now.
Yeah, way less than half an hour.
28. Do you have more presentations already, or you want to show us something more?
I think this is just the only thing to understand, that all the exchanges, that all the tools are outside, and all the exchanges are done through standard format.
Uh-huh.
We will have an API for filters in Python, we actually have money to actually. Get number of features done. So if there are different features
you are funding to work on the
We have funding for the whole project, Now we're funded by the Open Society Institute, the Your Soros Foundation, and we have another funder that has really accepted, but we haven't signed it.
Isn't it something that local governments will fund for? I mean, I probably think that in Spain you present the project to the Ministry of Industry and they will fund the project there, so saying there was time.
Well, this is something I tried to, but maybe Javier is more aware about this. I mentioned to a few people, I go to Bhutan in a few moments to attend the Zongka Linux launch event.
Yes.
And it's interesting because
In seconds.
And that project is government funded.
Yeah.
And my understanding is...
No, it's not government funded.
It's not?
No, it's funded by IDRC. I've been working in Bhutan.
Okay, yeah.
I have implemented.
But they try to get some support from governmental organization.
They are a governmental organization. This is the Department of Information Technology.
Yeah.
The government. So the people who are there are only government people.
Yeah. So I mean, if people working on a project are working for a governmental organization, in my opinion, this is a government-funded project. You know.
Yeah, but the money comes from somewhere else.
It might be interesting. I mean, maybe you can use the game resources for that too, because there's Debian people in a lot of countries, Latin America, Europe, whatever. And I think this project goes as something that could be local people get funding for, even if it's not a Debian project, but it's something that's going to be used by Debian.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, at least in Spain, I think that it would be very interesting for us to have that funding, because that means that the project continues, and if we're going to use it, we know it's going to be stable, we know there are going to be resources, we're going to think that we can maybe even not develop this stuff ourselves, without ask for that to be developed. And I mean, maybe that's something you can also think about, that the Debian Foundation thing, if they start using Poodle, they can also be a way to get funding from the
or institutional
organization. By the way, the WordPress Foundation, I'm going back to Spain on Monday. We're going to create the founder of the WordPress Foundation in Spain.
Uh-huh.
And we will be managing the WordPress project out of Spain. Even if it's virtually, it will be a Spanish organization.
And that's okay. We'll talk later about that.
Yeah, good.
Do you want to show us the conclusions?
This is what you're going to see when you go to Bhutan.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
They organize a one-day trip to this place.
Yeah. I'm already waiting for that.
Are you going to go?
Yeah, I'm going on for 3 or 4 days, just after that project. So I have to give a keynote lecture about
the all the official people.
Where?
Well, in Tifu.
Yeah, with the contact with Tema.
So he's doing a lot of work. Yeah, I show them the Debian installer in Zongka. We will have it in Nepalese too, and now we have it in Khmer, of course.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
We can turn it off.
I can show you Poodle with the
Nepalese
installer in Khmer.
Yes. Wait.
This is the latest version of Poodle.
Oh, okay.
And this is the, we will have the files for the
installer. The Khmer installer. They work in...
Tiny just sent me her Vietnamese files, but we didn't have to put them up. But the idea is that... It's a Debian, we go to this folder. And then we can actually work online and see the messages that are not translated, or we can just download the files. I think we only have folders 1, 2, and 3 here.
Internet here sucks.
Internet, yeah.
Good. But I have to say that I haven't tried this from any other connection.
Okay.
So not, but we're going to have a number of.
Yeah, it works.
We're going to have the number of...
And does it update automatically from the DI?
Not yet. So that's... We have to see the interface now. And now we have to connect this to make sure that it works correctly.
So currently the coordinator who happens to be
Kakada? No, it's Solan. Kakada is now a programmer for WordPress.
Oh, okay.
So we can just come on here and download the DO file. Just open it, or we can be then view the untranslated the untranslated messages in that file.
Oh, it's not complete.
And what's the actually the export?
Well, we have never reviewed the rest for our market. The?
Actually, export?
No, the version of doesn't use the XD yet. We're so finishing the base classes.
About footer specifically, before we run out of time, the general status of footer, Nicola, yes. Well, we actually have Nicola had a look at footer and tried to package it for Debian, because if at some moment we want to use something in Debian, it has to be packaged.
Yeah, sure. Yeah,
right? So,
it's stable.
Yeah, it's enforced stable, really.
Which we're not there yet.
So, well, this is basically where we are now, and the goal is having a Debian package for footer as soon as possible. It will not necessarily mean that use it natively, but then if we have a Debian package, we are in the situation where we have the Debian maintainers, and an upstream, which would happen to be WorldForge, and then we can collaborate. We have set up the foundations to collaboration, and that's good.
Yeah, this is good. We do have, as we was mentioned here before, some performance issues that we're working really hard on. And,
but does Poodle use a database backend, or is it
no,
just
we don't, we don't yet use the database. The problem with Poodle is that it uses PI Lucene.
What's that?
It's an indexing engine.
Uh-huh.
But it's used for searching strings, which is not an important feature.
Uh-huh.
So we have to we have done some basic work reducing to 1/4 for the time that we use for things. But we still need to do a lot of work on if we don't get a very smooth engine, then we cannot get any way to install Poodle. So we are very aware of that. Basically, we have the development plan for the year. We have what is now Poodle 0.9 stable that we are using. We're moving towards our next milestone is probably June, not first of May.
It depends on the specific version of Python. Yeah, I think so.
I don't know.
I think it's
but it works with 2.3, but I have some warnings.
Yeah.
And
I think
so.
I do think that we should focus on Edge going forward.
It's working on our golden string.
No, 2.4 I love Edge, but not the difference. It's very, very good. Question. Yeah, we are talking about the stable release. I think that we should focus the order development for Edge, right?
Yeah, when I speak about stable, I'm not speaking about such. We can compromise that everything that we run on Edge is okay. But because hopefully we know that we will release Edge on December 2006. Okay, we all know
it's releasing time.
Yeah, we will release on time. So
also because we always do that.
Yeah. So we will have to add when I say stable Debian, to be Edge. So if we depend on Python 2.4, Python 2.4 has it's in Edge.
Just to give you a very quick idea of the developments we're planning, the next version of Poodle work with things leak internally. And then export the other one. Then, after that, we do basic statistics so that we can show what's happening with these files. Then we work on rights management, like other volumes.
Yeah, something.
You know, defining very well the roles and the rights of each person, and doing that, and then we do the integration of glossary and translation memory inside the files. That's for us the next step. But it's important for us to have a stable version that works internally with the files and that can do basic statistics. To that, for us, that would be bullet 1.0.
Okay, that would be August, right? Or that would be September.
That would be before that. But that would be August. Yeah. I think that by September we would be able to.
About the development, is there a development team actually?
Yeah, there's a paid development team.
Yeah. Do you need help with that? Do you need more people there? We
could find more people, but I have to talk to the other co-director of the team that is doing Bagel.
Yeah.
They're working in South Africa, but we're working now, we're starting with on bounties for specific things, like for the statistics, but I'm sure that we could use more developers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, especially because now, we're going to have the second part for funding, and we'll have money for more developers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and where does the developer work? Do they have a mailing list?
No,
that's where are rotation, but do they have a mailing list or something that people...
Is everything in short, right?
Yeah, something that people interested in mailing would subscribe to and
That is also,
you have to subscribe to this.
That's also an IRC channel.
Yeah, that's also an IRC channel.
So, and then for goal, by the end of the year, we can do advanced statistics management of those, and this will be the leading to put it 2.0. But 1.0 is a stable file server that works internally with XD files, that can communicate well with CDS, and that will be this summer. So by the beginning of September, we will have a stable full 1.0, which has been tested. And then, by the end of the year, after we get a stable 1.5 with all the added value, we'll start working on distributed pool. On having several pools, either local pools or specific language pools or specific project pools, communicating between them. This actually is more a specification. We need to understand who would want to use their own server and how it has to communicate with the other servers.
I think we will have to cut it down because probably Beckland and Otavio want to prepare their own buff, so we have to give them.
Yes, I'm doing that.
I know you are doing your slides, you know?
You probably use the code for sure, but.
We'd love to collaborate. There's a DB team working on specification.
Yeah.
We would like to participate. We think that it's a good idea that Debian does its own specification.
Yeah. I think we'll probably match that this would be really fine. So, I mean, we're not going to. Actually, for some of the summer school guy, it actually doesn't make sense for us to tell him to write all this stuff. Because he's not going to be able to do that if he's not. There's no way.
So, we can, if we have that sum of code thing, maybe we can discuss with the people about which bounties you mentioned and maybe find some specific place which has some connections with Debian and we could assign this as a project and then something working. And as a second goal, I would say that having some of the developers in Extremadura would be nice.
We have been talking to them already.
Yeah.
One of the Luis Casas, he has been saying that maybe he can put one of the developers.
I would say that having Dwayne would be nice. It's a long trip from South.
Are there Spanish developers there on Warforge?
But the one person that is Spanish is Alberto Scudero.
But he's in Sweden.
He's in Sweden, and he's maintaining Poodle. So he's in charge of making sure that he's basically the client of the core teams, of the South African team. So Poodle is being developed in South Africa. The translation editor is being developed in Cambodia.
Mm-hmm.
And the core client is Alberto.
Mm-hmm.
So that he's the one that has to complain about things are working and to make sure that rule is running stable.
So I then I propose we continue with that.
Yeah.
We have to move.
We're working with the usability school in the US for development of interfaces to make sure that the interfaces are.
The interface makes a lot of work.
Yes.
When do you want to leave?
On the Monday.
Some people left their
I think you put it up at Homer.